Welcome back to Andrew Upshaw Fishing. Today's video, I'm not gonna lie guys, it's pretty good. It's gonna help you catch more fish next time you're on the water, especially if the lake you're fishing is flooded. That's right, and I'm not just saying like 6 inches high, I'm talking about flooded, like 3, 4, 5, 6 foot high. Those times where you look out there and you're like, where in the heck did those bass go? Today's video is gonna highlight 4 different techniques on targeting those particular bass. Guys, it's a good one. I'm just telling you straight up, this information you're about to get is pretty darn good. So make sure you stay tuned through the whole video and you're gonna see exactly what I'm talking about. In the meantime, there's about 30% of you that are watching this video, maybe even more, honestly. But there's about 30% of you that aren't subscribed to this channel. Go ahead and go down there and hit that subscribe button if you don't mind. I would greatly appreciate it. I do appreciate everybody that already subscribes to this channel. Y'all are the reason that I even sit down and film this stuff. So without y'all's support, I wouldn't be here. No doubt about it. In the meantime, guys, let's check out flooded conditions and how to catch more bass in them right after this. All right, guys, I'm gonna give you a scenario real quick. You're going to the lake. It's one of your favorite lakes. The fish are getting ready to spawn and the lake comes up 4 feet overnight, or maybe even over a couple day time span, but 4 feet of additional water. You go back to where those fish were spawning, you look down and it's mud, or maybe it's just, you don't even recognize it because it's just so different looking. This is something that you're gonna face time and time again all throughout the South, sometimes in other portions of the United States as well. I know we definitely deal with it in the South though. Smith Lake is dealing with it. Del Hollow is dealing with it. They have a tournament at Del Hollow this week, and those guys are absolutely having to deal with extreme flooded conditions. So this video is gonna highlight a few different ways to target those bass and to truly how to pattern those particular bass when those extreme floods happen. And I'm telling you, it does happen all throughout the South. We have to deal with it day in and day out. It's just one of those things. So we'll just take, for example, Smith Lake. I just came back from Smith Lake. I got to practice literally one day on the lake, and then they canceled the tournament or postponed the tournament to October. And I'll tell you straight up what I was doing. And this is a pattern that I have done for years on Smith, and especially in situations where it is flooded. So one of the things that I was doing was taking this right here. This is just a 3.75 inch Rage Swimmer right there on a weedless jig head. This is a 5/16 ounce jig head. That's just the one I always throw. And I'm taking this particular swim bait and I'm going to the very back end of drains. And what a drain is and the way that I can best describe this, is you'll have a flat on both sides. It'll be shallow, like 2 to 4 foot. And then it drops down into what you would call a creek channel or a drain. Well, whenever you have a lake that's come up, and I'm talking about really come up, like 4, 5, 6 feet, what it does is every one of these true drains, there's gonna be water that rolls off the hills, off the mountains and things like that. And the water is gonna funnel out of those drains. So there's gonna be a lot of moving water in the back ends of these pockets. And it doesn't have to be a creek, like a true creek. So just go ahead and put that out of your head. You don't have to look for a true creek in the very back of something, whatever. Just look for pockets where water is running in. And you can tell because when you pull in there, you're gonna see a lot of shad flickering. You're gonna see a lot of activity. I mean, just with your eyes, not with your depth finder, just with your eyes, you'll see stuff just happening all over the place. You might even see some loons diving. You're gonna see, you might even see a waterfall in the back. When you find that situation, that's when I go to the Rage Swimmer first. The Rage Swimmer on that light jig head, only like 10 pound test. I don't think you need heavy line. I mean, it's not like it's a weedless, you know, like as far as like having to set the hook really hard, you can just load into these fish with this weedless jig head. But the whole key to this is cast it out to the bottom. Like, I want it to hit the bottom and start cranking it back really slow. I use like a 6/8 to 1 reel in this. It's just a loose custom. But I'm throwing it out there, let it go to the bottom, and I'm reeling extremely, extremely slow. So in the situation, if the fish are in the drain itself, and you'll know, I mean, literally like first, second, third cast, if they're in it, because they'll eat it as soon as it goes in there. But whenever I'm casting the drain, I'm looking for those particular fish. And I use basically three colors on this, and it all depends on water clarity. I use a white one like this, 9 times out of 10, because the water is a little bit more stained that's coming in. So you want something that's a little louder, a little flashier. This one is going to get that job done. Ghost shad is another really good color, but that's if the water's starting to clear up a little bit. Ghost shad has a little more gray into it. Definitely is a really, really good color for that particular situation. So speaking of drains, the other bait that I turn to when fishing drains is a spinnerbait. And there's spinnerbaits come in a lot of shapes and sizes. I kind of do that whole keep it simple, stupid thing. I want something that's white, obviously. Maybe a little bit of color change, just has a little green in it. Maybe some chartreuse. I always, and I don't know why, don't ask me why, because I can't answer that, but I always just throw a double willow when it comes to drains, fishing drains, those waterfalls. And the reason being, I think, has a lot more to do with the fact that there's a lot of shad around. And obviously a double willow imitates shad about as good or better than anything out there. But I will do two different things. And it just kind of depends on the area of the country that I'm in. I'll either use, you know, a gold silver combination, kind of like this is the new tour grade spinnerbait by Strike King. Or I'll actually use a painted blade version, a white and chartreuse painted blade. I want one blade white, one blade chartreuse, and a white and chartreuse skirt. I use the Hack Attack spinnerbait. They're exclusively available at Academy. I think it's just like the Hack Attack Special or something. I saw them one day when I was in Academy, and I called up Strike King. I was like, hey, I need some of those spinnerbaits, because that's like my favorite color is that white and chartreuse blade. You'll get in certain situations, whether it's maybe the water's a little bit too dirty, or maybe you're just, and sometimes you catch them when the water's really clear too. Spotted bass, smallmouth really like that white and chartreuse blade. But for conditions like what I was dealing with last week, this particular combo here was the absolute killer. Just a white and green skirt. But I'm throwing that on bigger line, and I'll explain to you too what I'm doing with the spinnerbait. So when I'm catching them on the spinnerbait in the drain, I'm not actually fishing the drain. And this is how you can kind of break it down. You know, originally I'm throwing the swim bait right down the middle of the drain. So I want to make that cast right down the middle, let it go to the bottom, reel it in. Well, as I told you, drain comes up and it flattens out on both sides. Well, I use the spinnerbait to fish the flats on both sides. So I'll actually sit in the drain and kind of roll cast that spinnerbait around all the cover that's on the back sides of these drains, because there's going to be flooded bushes, trees, sometimes picnic tables, depending where you're at. The other time that I throw a spinnerbait in extreme flooded conditions, and this is kind of tricky, and this is a little sneaky pattern that works when those lakes are extremely overwhelmed with water, is going to people's yards or pastures or parks or boat ramps. So one of the biggest problems whenever you're dealing with really, really flooded conditions is the fact that you can't actually get to where the fish are. There's either too many trees, too many bushes. I mean, it's just practically impossible to get to the bank, because what these fish want to do is they want to suck to the bank when that water goes up. So you can't actually get there. So what, going to an actual park, sometimes a backyard, wherever it is where you can physically fish the bank, is your highest percentage area. Now granted, the only problem with that extreme flooded condition is that you're not going to find them extremely grouped up like you might before. So the bad thing is, as you, in your mind, you're like, man, I need to flip all this. This is phenomenal flipping cover. Well, that can actually cause a little bit of an issue. So that So what I do is the spinnerbait actually allows you to cover more water, and therefore you're gonna get more bites. And this is one of those situations where you need to cover as much water as you physically can, because the more yards and more parks, more anything that you fish that's flooded, the better chance that you have to catch them bass. Now, I actually rewind it to a win that Mark Pack had. And Mark Pack won at Beaver Lake, and he was actually fishing a lot of picnic tables and parks using, I think he was using a chatterbait. But the big deal was there is he was fishing a shad spawn that had developed because the lake had come so high. And a few years later at Beaver Lake, we had, and I want to say it was an 11-foot swing in water over about a 48-hour time span. And I was actually catching on a shad spawn as well. The deal is when that water, especially later in the year, like April, May, June, when that water starts to warm and you get those flooded conditions, those shad will actually, it kind of triggers them to go up there and spawn. So they'll go pull up in that shallow grass, those shallow bushes, all this new flooded cover, and they'll actually start spawning. And that's when that spinnerbait, a chatterbait, a swim jig, that's when that really starts to play extremely well. So another pattern that I really like to fish whenever I'm faced with those flooded conditions is a frog, but not just any frog. I use the poppin' perch. This is a Strike King poppin' perch. And you know, I'm really trying hard not to product push here because that's not what this video is about, but I truly only really throw the poppin' perch anymore. And I have to thank Todd Castledown for that, because he took me out on Rayburn one time and proved to me why the poppin' perch is so effective. And I can't put it down. It's, the thing is bad as a bone. You catch massive fish on it and a lot of them. But anyways, the whole pattern with the poppin' perch. So when the flooding happens, when the water comes up, one thing that definitely happens, especially around the springtime, is you're going to have a lot of lifted sawdust piles. So you're going to have a lot of basically temporary mats around of this stuff that is, it's like sawdust is basically what it is. It might be some grass, it might be some wood, all kind of floated up and kind of bunched into little pockets. So if I'm around the spawn like it is right now, these fish are trying to sun, they're trying to get hot, they're trying to get ready to get to go lay their eggs. Well, when that water's fluctuating, they're not going to spawn. They're going to pull off their beds, and a lot of times they're going to suck up under these floating debris piles, basically. So if you have an area that is a really good spawning area, and you know that there's always fish on beds in this area, and you know what I'm saying. Like, you've gone through there with like a cinco, you've caught them there on whatever it may be, a lizard. For years, this is how you've caught these fish. Well, now you can't catch them that way. You're just not going to catch them because they're going to be up under that sawdust. And that's when that poppin' perch really shines, because it's about one of the only baits that you can physically fish on those sawdust piles. I mean, there's no question about it. You can roll cast that thing around, you can skip it up undercover, you can fish it fast, and you can catch a lot of bass. I keep my colors extremely simple on the poppin' perch, especially this time of year. Especially in extremely flooded conditions, I either throw a black one or I throw a solid white one. You don't need a bunch of colors whenever you're dealing with that flooding condition. Now, in certain situations, like if you're dealing with extremely clear water, you might go to the clear one that we make. If you have a lot of bluegill around, you might throw the green pumpkin. You know, you can kind of color specify depending on your situation. But 9 times out of 10, if you're dealing with extreme floods, black and white will get it done. And a lot of times in tournaments, I'll have both of them tied on, and I'll kind of fling one around or the other around just to kind of see which one they eat the best and just kind of roll with it that day, because every day is a different day when you're out there on the water. Last but absolutely not least is the way that I catch them back home on Sam Rayburn and a lot of other places in this country when it's really flooded. And a lot of times it has to do with, you know, how I've caught them on these other baits. So when I go to a place like Sam Rayburn and it's flooded and it's 6 foot high and it's hard to catch them because you don't really, it just scatters them out. You know, the first thing I'll go throw is either the spinnerbait or the popping perch, and I'll fish it around bushes, and I just want to get one bite. That's it. One bite. If I get two bites, it's game on. No questions asked. But I just want to get one bite around the bushes. And I'll cover those bushes until I get that one particular bite. And that's when I pull out my flipping stick. And I pull out this bait in particular. This is the number one bait for me for flipping heavy cover, heavy bushes on Rayburn, Toledo Bend, any of those big fish lakes in the south when you deal with flooded conditions. And this is a Magnum Rage Bug. This is the bigger brother of just the regular Rage Bug. And it's truly about the only time I flip this big bait, if I'm being honest. Like, I rarely throw the Magnum Rage Bug unless I'm flipping bushes. But that big bug absolutely catches giants. Right here, I have it on a quarter ounce. And I came from Florida, so I was flipping it around some grass. And I was flipping a quarter ounce. But I don't flip a quarter ounce when I'm flipping those big bushes. And I'm talking, when I'm talking big bushes, I'm talking like true trees, like willow trees. And bushes that are 6 foot under the water. So I want like a half to three quarter ounce weight. And you heard that right, half to three quarter ounce weight. I'll actually go to 25 to 30 pound fluorocarbon or 50 to 65 pound braid, depending on just how big these fish are. I've been in certain situations where when you got a bite, it was a 4+, no questions asked. Like, you might catch a 2 pounder or 2.5, 3, but 9 times out of 10, it was a 4+, and it was a battle. And if you didn't have braid, if you didn't have a giant rod to winch them out of there, you weren't going to land that fish. Because let's look at it this way. Your bait's falling through this bush, okay? And there's, you know, you're passing 30 limbs going down. It goes to the bottom of this bush, and you hop it up one time, and that fish eats it. Well, if you hesitate for even a split second, all that fish has to do is move over 1 foot, and he's got you tangled in every single branch that you just came through. So landing that fish can be extremely, extremely difficult. That's why that braid is extremely important. So when you bow up on that fish, you got to have as much power and leverage on that fish as you physically can, or you're going to lose it. And then a lot of times you're going to lose it anyway. Nobody's 100% perfect when you're talking about 6 to 8 foot bushes. So guys, overall, that's my 4 different techniques for targeting flooded condition bass. You know, it's not made in science, and there's absolutely other ways to catch them. If you have one of those other ways, enlighten me. Drop me a comment below and tell me how you catch flooded condition bass this time of year. And I'm not talking the fall or summer. I'm mainly talking in the spring, because this is when we get our mass amount of floods. This is when a lot of our lakes and rivers rise to an extreme level and making fishing difficult. Guys, if you get a chance, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. I really would appreciate it. I hope the next time you're on the water, you catch your new personal best, and maybe it'll be on one of the baits listed below. Thank you again, and I'll see you next time.